have Christians who think that it's just all about the suffering and all about the you know, we see, it's like we see pictures of Jesus, you know, you see all the pictures of Jesus with a solemn look on his face. You know, you saw the paintings? Come on, you see the paintings of Jesus. My child. You know, that's not the way he looked all the time, okay? Just when he was posing for those paintings, that's the only time he looked like that. But God wants you to be happy, you're his child. So, of course, he wants us to have happiness. We talk about joy as Christians, but then we look like we have a root canal when we walk around. We can't, for some reason, because of the smaller portion of Scripture, it says there's joy in sin for the season. We also think that joy is the sin for the season for some reason. And so a lot of Christians walk around with this lemony scowl on their face, you know? And that's not what God is looking for. In Romans 15:13, it said, "Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you believe in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit." Does that sound like a God who doesn't want you to be happy? Does that sound like someone who wants you to walk around with that limited scowl on your face all the time, looking like the pictures that we think Jesus posed for? No. He wants you to be happy. I mean, the Bible, I don't know where we get all this stuff from. I mean, the Bible is chock full of Scripture about how he wants us to have joy and peace, and just look at the gifts of the Holy Spirit and the fruit of the Spirit. And he wants you to be happy. He wants you to be joyful. John 16, verse 24. Until now, you have asked for nothing in my name. Ask and you will receive, so that your joy may be complete. Not only does God want you to be happy, but this scripture always indicates something that a lot of people would think is heresy. That ask anything in my name, and you will receive it. So basically, you're receiving things. Maybe healing, maybe prosperity, maybe, I don't know, you're asking for a new car, if he gives you a new car, maybe so, I don't know. But you're asking God for something. Maybe, I mean, like, my wife, she wanted 18 kids, and she was driving around with a little piece of soul. Have you seen those? You're not fitting but a few kids in that. So she prayed and asked God for a new car, and so we got a van, and now she's filling it up. And you can't fit nobody else in there, so don't try to be sending anybody with us. But you know, it's not only spiritual things that we're allowed to ask God for. It's not only the Lord, make me patient and make me kind. It's not only those things that we can ask God for. God says in his word that you can ask him. If you went and you were a part of the small group study that we did about the circle maker, you read in that book where it's okay to ask God for big, bold prayers and just pray bold prayers to him about things in your life. It's okay to ask God for stuff. But then, this is the part where it gets a little crazy, okay? You will receive these things so that your joy may be complete. It almost sounds, I say almost because I don't want everybody to get mad at me, but it almost sounds like some of your joy comes from things. What? That can't be right. It can't be right. That's not what we're taught. Your joy can only come from Jesus. It can't come from anywhere else. It can't come from things. Well, he says here, sometimes some of your joy may come from things. Just stay with me. I'll get there. The issue isn't with enjoying your stuff. The part that some people think are heresy isn't from enjoying the stuff that God blesses you with. The issue is that we enjoy the stuff without acknowledging the origin. There's nothing wrong with enjoying the great things that God's given you in your life. You're not a sinner bound for hell if you enjoy the car that you drive. Let me tell you, I love my truck. My truck is like 10 or so years old. And you know, my wife hates riding my truck, probably because I need to clean it out. But I think that's clearly a matching the button. Yes. But even when it's cleaned out and nice and shiny, back when it was, she hates my truck. I love my truck. In fact, when I have the choice of driving her van or my truck, I'm like, let's drive my truck. I love my truck. I enjoy the blessing of my truck that God gave me. I'm one of those. I want to drive until the wheels fall off. I don't want a new truck. I want my old truck. I love it and I want it. But whether you drive a new truck, an old truck, a bicycle, whatever you drive, whatever you have in your life, maybe it's your PS, are we on 4? Xbox. I know Marcus is a gamer. You know? He likes his gamer. He likes his this thing. Whatever it is in the life that God's given you, it's okay to absolutely enjoy and find happiness in that thing, as long as you don't neglect understanding and acknowledging the origin of those things. The Bible says that all good and perfect gifts come from where? That's right. Above. Everything you have that's brought joy to your life comes from God. There's nothing wrong with enjoying those things. He wants you to be happy. He wants you to be glad. He wants you to have joy in your heart. And sometimes it's from those things. We sit up here and we just talk about just the peace in our heart and the joy that's in our heart, but we don't talk about where they come from. Sometimes they come from God giving us stuff. You know? And I know that that's not super spiritual. And I know that's not, you know, nobody's writing a book about that. I get it. But sometimes we need to come back and acknowledge the things that we are easy to understand, which is sometimes still school. I like gadgets. You know? Everybody who knows me, I like a gadget. Me and Simeon have an app on our phone with nothing but gadgets. And he buys them, and I say, wow, that's cool. Like, my wife won't let me. Gladness without gratitude or thanksgiving is one of the most dangerous things in a Christian's life. Gladness in and of itself, happiness, can begin and end with you. Just think about that for a second. Gladness in and of itself, without thanksgiving, begins and ends with you. If I'm Marcus and I got the Xbox and I'm playing Halo, whatever, you know, that makes me happy. I'm excited. I'm playing. There's nobody else involved there. It's just me, myself, and I. I'm enjoying it. I'm getting gladness from it. If I don't acknowledge where the things in my life come from, then I think they're all from me. My gladness was attained by me. My happiness was attained by me. It's until you add the thanksgiving to your gladness, where there's that second party involved, where it doesn't begin and end with you, that is where you will find true happiness. Because there's a limit, a big limit, to what I can provide by myself. With God, there is no limit. With God, there's no limit to the provision, to the healing, to all the things in your life that you say you want. See, most of us and the world around us, we're totally cool being happy by ourselves. You know? Like I said, you can have happiness begin and end with you, and it's totally cool. You'll be happy for that moment. We're totally cool being happy by ourselves. But nobody will be sad alone. Right? Nobody wants to be in despair alone. We're totally cool being happy by ourselves. We're totally cool being happy and not acknowledging where that joy comes from. But suddenly, when the trouble hits, we want God to be there with us. Right? If you allow gladness in your heart without thanksgiving, then you will also allow sadness in your heart with no hope. You can't have either or. People try to, it becomes extremely difficult. But if you have happiness in your heart and do not include the provider of that happiness with that thanksgiving, then when the time of despair comes in your heart, you will also be enduring that alone. You can't just include him in the hard times. You can't just bring him in when things are going wrong. If you depend on your circumstances to bring you happiness, then your circumstances are also 100% in control of your sadness. Does that make sense? If you're thanksgiving with gladness and acknowledging his part in your joy, then suddenly when things go wrong, he's there by your side. See, we're afraid of despair. Like I said, we're totally cool being happy by ourselves. We're afraid of despair. We're afraid. I mean, think about it right now. In your mind, if when you go home, just think of, worst case scenario. Let's not even go worst case. Let's go one step up. Let's go think not like that. Dude. Nobody likes that. Nobody wants things to go wrong in your life. We're afraid of that. Think about what keeps you up at night, the things that worry you. Just at any moment in your day, think about the things that you're worried about. You are scared of those things. God is not scared of those things. God is not afraid of your despair. God is not afraid of your trouble. But yet we want to alienate him when we're up on the mountain. Well, if God on the mountain, God in the valley, I'm pretty sure that's an old Southern gospel song. I'm not going to say anything more about it because the pastor will have this compulsion to start singing it. I promise you, if we were not in church right now, he would be singing. And it's really weird. But yeah, thank you. Thank you. He's broken. He's kind of calming down. He wants to sing it. He knows the purpose behind the blessings in your life. He knows why he sends them. And he expects to be thanked for it. He expects to be acknowledged. He expects gratitude for those things. Because he knows why he sent them. He knows the joy he wants them to bring. But see, the thing is, if we're trusting him and acknowledging him and thanking him in those times, then we have to acknowledge him and thank him in the hard times. See, the pastor talked last week about praising God in the midst of your horrible circumstances, in the midst of your trouble, about praising him. That doesn't come second nature. That doesn't come easy. And the thing is, for a lot of you last week, you may have had a tough time with that. If you're not including him in every facet of your life, then the time when you need him the most, you're going to struggle. And I know that for some of you are like, well, duh, yeah. But think about if you're not thanking him about the things in your life, if you're not acknowledging him when times are good, then you will be stuck in times that are bad, stressed out, the mind going crazy, trying to figure out a solution to this problem. And suddenly you're supposed to trust God? See, if things are good, money's great, the job's fantastic, the kids are being good, all these things. What risk is there in trusting God at that moment? Everything's good. It's cool. Thank you, God. Let me have this. Let me build this relationship now. Because to try to build a relationship with God when the world is absolutely going crazy is the most difficult time in the world for you to do that. And we do that so often. That's us. That's our mentality. All right, God, thank you all. I love you so much. All right, cool. I'll see you in about 6 months when things go crazy in my life. Thank you. That's us. Mike is not cooperating. That's us right there. We want to have God in reserve. We want to have God in our back pocket for when things go bad. He wants to be not in your back pocket. He wants to be in front of you, beside you, walking with you every step of the way, every day, and every good moment in your life. He wants to enjoy it with you. He wants to be the guy holding bottom of your pictures. Not really, but he wants to be in every part of your life, not just the bad parts. Man, what kind of relationship was that? I got a friend like that. No. We got a friend like that. Who the only time he calls, the only time he wants anything is when things are going absolutely crazy in his life. Doesn't want to come and just hang out. Doesn't want to just be friends. I mean, think about it. You don't want to be anybody's emergency policy. You want to be somebody's friend. God wants the same thing. He wants to be at the birthday party. You know, he wants to be there with you in a relationship with you where every morning when you get up and you thank him for the day. You thank him for your family. You thank him for all the things that he has given you in your life. And don't even stand up there for a minute and even think that you had any control and any input on the things happening in your life because you didn't. They're only there by his good grace. They're only there by his mercy on our life. They're only there because he loves you and wants you happy. Yeah. You know, it's just about sitting in that class. Being thankful to God is in many ways a precursor to trusting him in those moments. It's two sides of the same coin, and that coin is depending totally and completely on God. Psalm 7 and 17. I will thank the Lord for his righteousness. I will sing about the name of Yahweh, the Most High. If you don't have anything to thank God for in your life, well, one, you're crazy, because that's certainly everybody has something to thank God for. If you don't thank him for his righteousness, thank him for his righteous love. The fact that he came and died for us on a cross when we were just, oh, you know who you used to be. I know who I used to be. I know the person inside that keeps trying to rear its ugly head. He died for that person. He didn't die for the great guy who's just perfect in every way. He died for the ugliness inside. We all got it. We all got it. Don't play like you don't. Psalms 28:7. The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts him, and I am helped. Therefore, my heart rejoices, and I praise him with a song. David's talking about shields and having trust in him. Doesn't sound like a party up there. Nobody says, hey, we're having a party. Make sure you bring your shield and your sword. You know? And if you do, I don't want to go to that kind of party. David's talking about a battle here. He's talking about times that are tough, times that are crazy. But yet he says, therefore my heart rejoices. That means he's happy. And I will praise him with my song. Let me tell you, to do that in that moment, to rejoice when David is in turmoil, when he needs that shield, he's able to do that because he was able to praise God and acknowledge God and thank God when things were good in his life. You cannot have it both ways. You can't sit there and think that you rule the world and you've accomplished and accumulated all this great stuff that brings you so much joy and then expect God to be there at your beck and call. He wants your whole heart. Jeremiah 29:11 and 12 and 13. For I know the plans I have for you. This is the Lord's declaration. Plans for your welfare, not for disaster. To give you a future and a hope. Man, those things sound good, don't they? You will call to me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you search for me with your whole heart. It's one of my favorite scriptures in the Bible, especially that last part, because we have to understand that part. We have to understand verse 13. You have to understand that you will seek him and you will find him. Like that song we sang, when we seek him with our whole heart, not just the heart of despair. Not just the heart that is going through the tough time, and you're in the hospital bed, you're crying out to him. With your whole heart. You're his child. He wants to experience life with you. He wants you to acknowledge him every day. Me and the pastor went over to see Linda Griffith last week when she was at home. Linda has been through a tough time and continue to pray for her. But I tell you, her and Ken both, they were a good spirit. She's laying there, just out of the hospital, shortly after we're back to the hospital. A lot of people at that point are searching for God. But she had him right by her side. Because in the good times, he was there with them. And at that moment, she knew who was there with her. Not to say it's easy in those times, but if he's there with you all the time, you ain't got to look for him. You don't start searching for God, let me find you. Let me find my answer. Your answer's there with you. Moment when you're crying out saying, help me. We say we want that in that moment. Like the pastor talked about last week in your despair, in your trouble, in your storm. We say we want that. But we're not minds if we have not thanked him in the good times and had that relationship with him in the good times. Will our minds allow us to let go of the trouble and trust him? We've held on to the good times. We've held on to the ownership of our happiness. If you do that, I promise you, you will have a tough fight not holding on to the ownership of your sorrow. You will want to own it. You will want to fix it. God said, just trust me. I will fix it. And in our minds, we're like, God, take it. But I promise you, the mind is a very strange thing. You can say with your mouth, God, help me. But if you do not let go, if you do not allow him to help you, his hands are tied. beginning, in the midst of your happiness, is preparing your life for the trouble that will come. We don't want it. It stinks. I know. The Bible's very clear. It reigns in the just and the unjust. The Bible says, surely you will have trouble. There are going to be times in your life when you need what only God can provide. There are going to be times in your life where you're searching for an answer and you cannot find it. When He is the only answer, you have to prepare yourself for those moments. You know the answer is God, and you'll cry out to Him in your sorrow. He wants to be more than your security blanket. He wants to be more. He wants to walk beside you every day. It's with thanksgiving that we draw close to God. Because immediately you're acknowledging where your joy comes from. It's with thanksgiving, with praise, that you immediately take a step closer to the throne of God. And by withholding that, you build a wall between you and Him. Let's pray. Lord, thank you, God, for everything, the things that we want to just pretend like our joy can only come from stuff super spiritual. But God, I know you give me everything. My house, the car I drive, my children, my wife, my church. The things that I find joy in life, I know they come from you. Lord, let us never rob you of your due credit. Let us never rob you of that understanding that all good and perfect gifts, they come from you. Lord, I pray today that every person here will acknowledge with their heart and with their life, not just today, but tomorrow when they wake up, when they sit their feet on the ground, that we acknowledge you and welcome you into our lives as we walk forward. Throughout our day tomorrow, we don't want you just if something goes bad, but we want you in our life because you are God, you are our best friend, you are our everything. Elders to come up front, and in just a minute, and if you want to come up here and pray, that's cool. If you want to do it in your seat, that's totally cool. Whatever you want to do, but I want our elders to come up front, and if there is a need in your life, and if you're in that moment of sorrow, if you're in that moment of trouble, and you need prayer, they're here for you, and they will help you to pray and help you through that moment. But I want to challenge us today. Take a moment of rededication. Of rededication of our good times in life to God.